Manish. Thanks for being here at the EDUCAUSE Annual Conference. And you know that innovation is critical for education. Don't need to tell you that story. What do we need to be doing to foster innovation in higher education?
Well, I see three things that are critically important as we transition our educational system, both K-12 and higher ed, to the challenges and opportunities of the 21st century. First, we've got to make sure that we have sufficient infrastructure for innovation. In our opinion, the combination of mobile and cloud computing will be critical ingredients to facilitate the kind of innovations that we're seeing out there in Startup Alley. Second, I think we got to work together on the right policies that ensure we have rules of the road to both invite innovation but protect the key areas that need protection: student data privacy, ensuring we have security on the information that's flowing and so forth, which we can do and we should do in a way that is more innovation friendly. And then last but certainly not least, we need to create a sort of an environment that fosters innovation to bring new applications and products and services to market for all the challenges that we face: retaining students, emphasizing careers in science, technology, engineering, and mathematics, achieving higher education completion rates. All of these challenges can be met if we in fact create the conditions. And that final point is about data as an asset for those conditions.
Tell us more about data, because that's something everyone's awash in data, but they really want to get the value out of it. So how do we link to the right sources of data and get that value?
Well, I would say it's fascinating. Number one is just to acknowledge that most of the uses of data are not what you initially intended them to do. So it's important as your members choose to buy new products and services that produce data, that they think about the reusability of that data very much as the initial purpose of it. So that's why the president called for us to create more machine-readable access to information, because it's almost the secondary use that will create more value than the primary. So the first point is that we have sort of a data acknowledgement that it's an asset and that we think of its reuse as a method to open up the value of that asset. Second, I think we should do more to engage in voluntary bottom-up consensus standards activities. We have a number of very, very thoughtful standards bodies that have done great work in opening up data standards for transcript data and syllabus and all these other elements. And now we got to drive the adoption. And I think getting some kind of bottom-up collaboration going. We heard today a number of universities saying they're going to step up and offer simple machine-readable formats for student transcript data, and we're going to try to do that in 90 days. So I think the third point I would get is, one is accept the value, think about the standards opportunity. The third one is we should increasingly think of challenges, prizes, and competitions, even on the university campus, to say, how do we experiment, try new ideas, focusing on results? I think we do those three things, we're going to drive innovation.
How about how we build the market? You visited Startup Alley and we have some new companies. We've got higher education institutions talking to them. How do we bring the right people together in greater frequency with faster results?
Well, number one, I want to applaud EDUCAUSE for organizing Startup Alley, and I want to give a shout out to Mike Slayton for helping to put this together. We do have an opportunity just to build relationships. Oftentimes people think of it, everything's a vendor supplier relationship. What you heard today in Startup Alley is more than half the companies there didn't want to actually sell to the CIO. They wanted the data from the CIO to fuel their own business lines, where the relationship is about the information flows in a safe, secure way, as opposed to a contractual one. That's a new model of collaboration, and one I think that Startup Alley is fostering that dialogue. Second, I think there's a lot of interest in figuring out what are the business models that will evolve as we think about the educational system of the future. With gainful employment, just in the for-profit schools as an example, now there's a premium to be paid for ensuring that students are successful in the classroom and can achieve jobs and opportunities for economic growth upon graduation. That's going to create a new set of products and services that will support that business need. And I think there's going to be a lot of, I think capital will flow and products and services will thrive in that outcomes-driven world. That may also carry over into the not-for-profit space, which would be very exciting. And then I think the third thing that Startup Alley is doing is allowing folks to think a little bit differently about, are we in fact supplier diverse? We talked a little bit earlier with CEO, the CIOs. Most have supplier diversity programs, but they typically think of them in the context of, you know, additional maintenance support for their campus construction work. I thought the CIOs engaging in supplier diversity for their data and IT needs was an interesting twist that also could bring some life to the Startup Alley discussion.
So if you could leave our colleagues with one thought about where higher education needs to be in a few years, where would you have us point ourselves?
Well, the president has called on us to achieve a college attainment rate that's second to none in the world. And that means we've got to do a better job of retaining the students that enter our schools and attracting more in new and creative ways. So I would think of those as two interesting product lines. What are the set of products and services the campuses are going to create to foster more retention, especially in science, technology, engineering, and mathematics? We could actually graduate 10,000 more engineers in this country if we just retained them. That's a phenomenal impact to the American economy. And then what are the new products and services? Could we extend our schools offering lower cost alternative credential programs? I saw a lot of universities experimenting with the idea that they could offer a degree or course credit in alternative methods that are lower cost and perhaps more accessible for students. So we're going to see innovations in these two domains, retention and access expansion through productivity gains, which I think will be phenomenal for the EDUCAUSE community to dive into.
I really appreciate you being here. You have energized the entire community. You give us ideas. We watch what you do in other sectors, and
we're going to do it in higher ed.
Higher ed is going to do it.
And we're going to do them in 90 days. Thinking of budget cycles and authorization cycles. What you're going to see today, you mark my words, 3 months from today, you're going to see progress. We're going to see schools offering blue button-like services. We're going to see data published in creative formats from early adopters, and I hope that will scale across the country.
It's a deal.
Thank you for having me.
Thank you.